Also, there is a condemnation from the Islamic world itself against the extremism and then the barbaric acts of ISIS. So that's also a good thing. There are a lot of moderate Islamist or the Islamic scholars talking against ISIS. So having said that, yes, ISIS can turn, because like if you look at the area that they are focusing is basically the Middle East, I mean the Syria and Iraq. And also they are influencing, if you look at the ISIS map, the caliphate, it includes even Sri Lanka. So that's a bit of a dangerous part. And it will include India. So for them, the Muslim dominated, not even Muslim majority countries should be part of this caliphate. So that's their argument. But when you look at the Indian Ocean per se, and Strait of Hormuz, Bab el-Mandeb, that area is within the sphere of influence of the ISIS. And we know how narrow Bab el-Mandeb is and how narrow Strait of Hormuz is. And if they decide, and also we know the situation in Yemen is not very stable, and situation, the Horn of Africa in Somalia is not very stable. And so there is a potential danger if they decide to go for maritime, and they threaten the Western shipping, that if they are moving, they will target the Western shipping. Only thing, they could not materialize their threat, it didn't materialize. But there is a potential, especially on those areas, I would say, that if the ISIS decide to take on the merchant targets, it will be another effort will be needed by the international coalition forces to tackle that problem. So we need to be mindful. Maybe we are a little immune from that area, but that's a fact. Thank you.
Do you want to make a comment? Yes.
Thank you, sir, for your comment. I agree with you. It's the United States defense strategy more into economic interest, I think, even and maritime interest. So I agree with you. Thank you so much.
I'm Commander Kumar from Sri Lanka Navy. I have a question to be asked from Ms. Madanayaka. So you talk about the US strategy for Asia, especially with regard to your concern, the US concern of the rising presence of Chinese in Indian Ocean region. So what do you really think, even this is somewhat related to what you mentioned earlier also. So if we take the US-China trade volume, which is far beyond, far beyond the US-Indian and Indian-Chinese trade. So will it be, when we talk about the Chinese presence, the concern, US concern of the Chinese presence in Indian Ocean region, is it, will they focus on the security issues at the cost of trade, which is far beyond when we talk about US-Chinese trade relations? So what is your opinion on this?
Thank you, sir. I think, yeah, you are correct. I think they are always concerning about their security rather than trade, because even, you know, that United States has a lot of security issues even in their country and, you know, also in the Indian Ocean. So I think as a superpower, they need to upgrade their hegemonic power also, because it's a, you know, national interest for all countries. It's the major standpoint for us, for all the superpowers. So I think even US, China, even in India, Pakistan and Russia, all the powers, even not only superpowers, all powers are concerning their national interest, national security. In that sense, I think they are more security interested, and as well as economy, because economic power is also really important for a country to extend their powers with other countries.
Yes, you raised your hand. Yeah.
I'm Lieutenant Colonel Chanda Padmashanta. My question is focused to the Mr. Asante and the Mrs. Madanayaka, because you all are talking about the India's economic politics. When you consider about the 1997, when this Shri Jayajana came to power in 1997, then we aligned with the USA. At that time, the India strongly opposed it, and there's a struggle came, then we have to undergo a 26th of brutal war. So when now in Sri Lanka is enhancing their economic and the other diplomatic relationship with the other, especially China and the other countries, normally the Indian feathers will be shivering. And due to the Sambantota porting and the other, this the Colombo city ports, the mega projects also, the shuffled Indian feathers. Now my question is, now you know that as Asanka very correctly brought it out, concerning of the CEPA agreement, that's advantages is more getting by the India. But now the discussions is on the process to implement the ECTA. Now, if Sri Lanka wants to get more advantage, significant advantage than the CEPA from the ECTA, then what are the significant areas to be considered? That's my question.
Yeah, shall we? Yes.
Thank you, Colonel, for the question. Yeah, when we study about India or the India-Sri Lanka relation, what we have to think is in realistic terms, not on idealistic terms. In the anarchical system, India is a powerful country and Sri Lanka is a small country. And also, throughout the history, it is clear that we fall under the Indian sphere of influence. So when we build our relations with external powers, it can be West during the Cold War time period, and after that with China, India looks in a suspicious eye. You know, for everything there is a limit, like. There were, in very recent times, with the arrival of the Chinese president here, it was noted there were some, I don't know if this is really true, some Chinese nuclear submarines visited Sri Lanka. That was an alarming sign. That maybe some alarming sign on the whole issue. Therefore, we have to have a balance act. The next thing is, we can benefit from these economic agreement, but we have to formalize those things in a such a way. For example, our apparel industry, most of our apparel industry now going to India and Bangladesh because the production cost, the salaries that we have to pay is high. But we can bring labor from India. That way we can benefit. But the professionals, of course, there's a great danger for our professionals because there are so many professionals in India which, with so much of qualifications, who are ready to work for lower salaries. So that aspect somehow we are looking. But again, we can look into another aspect, that is where like China has done this. They have special economic zones, kind of autonomous regions, where they the central government maintain a different economic policy. Like if we are to build Hambantota, we can have a special agreement. Indian professionals can come, workers can come, but work within that certain limit, in that area only, that certain economic area, because even our people are reluctant to go there and work. That way we can benefit. And also there are huge, as the economy, India's economy is so huge, we can attract many investments, but we have to study well. We have to analyze the whole thing because India is a huge country compared to Sri Lanka. That is why.
Thank you.
Can
you
make any
comment?
Regarding this question?
Yeah. ECTA.
As I said, we have few geopolitical options. So we have to accept the sphere of influence of India, because culturally, traditionally, we are inbound with Indian sphere of influence. We cannot deviate from that. But in that case, we are not going to tell that